Recorded Books presents Sweet Myth-Tery of Life by Robert Asprin, narrated by Noah Michael Levine.
Chapter 1. Is it just me, or does it seem to you I get more than my share of trouble? Job. And so, to recap, the situation is this. I tick the points off on my fingers, giving my audience a visual image to reinforce my words. First, Queen Hemlock wants me to be her consort. Second, she's given me a month to think it over before I reach my decision. Third, I tap the appropriate finger for emphasis, if I decide not to marry her, she says she'll abdicate, naming me her successor and sticking me with the whole mess. Got that? Despite my concern over my predicament, I was nonetheless proud of my ability to address the problem head-on, summarizing and analyzing it as I sought a solution. There was a time in the not-too-distant past when I simply would have lapsed into blind panic. If nothing else, my adventures over the years had done wonders for my confidence in my abilities to handle nearly any crisis.
Gleep!
My audience responded. Okay, so I wasn't all that confident. While I knew I could muddle through most crises, the one situation I had dreaded the most was making a fool of myself in front of my friends and colleagues. While they had always been unswerving in their loyalty and willingness to bail me out of whatever mess I blundered into, that didn't mean I was particularly eager to tax our friendships yet another time, even if it was just for advice. At the very least, I figured that when I did approach them, I should be as level-headed and mature about it as possible, rather than babbling hysterically about my woes. Consequently, I decided to rehearse my appeal in front of the one member of our crew I felt truly comfortable with, my pet dragon. I've always maintained that Gleep is quite bright, despite the one-word vocabulary that gave him his name. According to my partner and mentor, Oz, my pet's limited vocal range was merely a sign of his immaturity, and it would expand as he edged toward adulthood. Of course, realizing dragons live several centuries, the odds of my ever having a two-way conversation with Gleep were slim. At times like this, however, I actually appreciated having someone to talk to who could only listen, without helpful asides regarding my inability to walk across the street without landing myself and the crew in some kind of trouble. The trouble is, I continued, what with all the problems and disasters I've had to cope with over the years, not to mention trying to be president of Myth, Inc., I haven't had much time for a love life. Like, none at all. And I sure haven't given any thought to getting married. I mean, I haven't ever really reached a decision on whether or not I want to get married at all, much less when or to who. Gleep cocked his head to one side, to all appearances hanging on my every word. Of course, I do know I'm not wild about the alternative. I had a chance to play king once, and that was twice too often, thank you. It was bad enough when I was just being a stand-in for Roderick, but the idea of trying to run the kingdom by myself, as myself, and forever, not just for a few days, well, that's flat-out terrifying. The question is it more or less terrifying than the idea of being married to Queen Hemlock? My pet responded to my dilemma by vigorously chewing at an itch on his foot. Thanks a lot, Gleep old boy, I said, smiling wryly despite my ill humor. While I obviously hadn't really expected any glowing words of advice from my dragon, I had at least thought my problems were serious enough to hold his attention. I might as well be talking to Oz. At least he looks at me while he's chewing me out. Still smiling, I picked up the goblet of wine I had brought with me for moral support and started to take a sip.
Oh, Oz isn't so bad.
For a startled moment, I thought Gleep had answered me. Then I realized the voice had come from behind me, not from my pet. A quick glance over my shoulder confirmed my worst fears. My partner, green scales, pointed teeth and all, was leaning against the wall not 10 feet from where I stood and had apparently been listening to my whole oration.
Hi, Oz, I said, covering my embarrassment with a forced smile. I didn't hear you come in. Sorry about that last comment, but I've been a little...
Don't worry about it, Skeeve.
He interrupted with a wave of dismissal.
If that's the worst you've had to say about me over the years, I figure we've been doing pretty well. I do lean on you kind of hard from time to time. I guess that's gotten to be my way of dealing with stress.
Oz seemed calm enough. In fact, he seemed to be suspiciously calm. While I wasn't wild about his shouting at me, at least it was consistent. This new display of reasonability was making me uneasy, rather like suddenly noticing the sun just rose in the west.
So, what are you doing here, partner?
I said, trying to sound casual.
I was looking for you. It occurred to me that you might need a sympathetic ear while you figured out what to do next.
Again, a small warning gong went off in the back of my mind. Of all the phrases that might occur to me to describe Oz's interaction with me in the past, a sympathetic ear wasn't one of them.
How did you know where I was?
I was dodging the issue, but genuinely curious as to how Oz found me. I had taken great pains to slip down to the royal stables unnoticed.
It wasn't hard,
Oz said, flashing a grin as he jerked his thumb at the door.
You've got quite a crowd hanging around outside.
I do?
Sure. Pookie may be a bit mouthy for my taste, but she knows her stuff as a bodyguard. I think she's been tailing you from the time you left your room.
Pookie was the new bodyguard I had acquired during my recent trip to Perv, before I knew she was Oz's cousin.
That's funny, I scowled. I never saw her.
Hey, I said she was good, my partner winked. Just because she respects your privacy and stays out of sight doesn't mean she's going to let you wander around unescorted. Anyway, I guess Guido spotted her and decided to tag along. He's been following her around like a puppy ever since they met. And of course, that meant Nunzio had to come too. And, well, the end result is you've got all three of your bodyguards posted outside the door, to see to it that you aren't disturbed.
Terrific. I start out looking for a little privacy and end up leading a parade.
So, what do you think, Oz? I said.
I knew I was going to get his opinion sooner or later, and figured I might as well ask outright and get it over with.
About what?
About my problem, I clarified.
What problem?
Sorry, I thought you had been listening when I explained it to Gleep. I'm talking about the whole situation with Queen Hemlock.
I know,
my partner said.
And I repeat, what problem?
What problem? I was starting to lose it a little, which is not an unusual result of talking to Oz. Don't you think...
Hold on a second, partner,
Oz said, holding up his hand.
Do you remember the situation when we first met?
Sure.
Let me refresh your memory anyway. Your old mentor Garkin had just been killed, and there was every chance you were next on the hit list, right?
Right, but...
Now that was a problem,
he continued, as if I hadn't spoken.
Just like it was a problem when you had to stop Big Julie's army with a handful of misfits, realizing that if you were successful, Grimble was threatening to have you killed, or worse, when you returned to the palace.
I remember.
And when you decided to try to clear me of that murder rap over in Limbo, a dimension which just happens to be filled with vampires and werewolves, I'd say that was a problem, too.
I don't see what...
Now, in direct contrast, let's examine the current situation. As I understand it, you're in danger of getting married to the Queen, which, I believe, includes having free run of the kingdom's treasury. The other option is that you decide not to marry her, whereupon she abdicates to you, leaving you again with a free hand on the treasury, only without the Queen.
He showed me his impressive array of teeth.
I repeat, what's the problem?
Not for the first time, it occurred to me that my partner had a tendency to appraise the pluses and minuses of any situation by the simple technique of reducing everything to monetary terms and scrutinizing the bottom line. The problem is, I said tersely, that in order to get that access to the treasury, I have to get married or become king. Frankly, I'm not sure I'm wild about either option.
Compared to what you've been through in the past to scrape together a few coins, it's not bad.
I shrugged.
Face it, Skeeve, making a bundle usually involves something unpleasant. Nobody, and I mean nobody, is going to fork over hard cash for your having a good time.
Of course, those few coins we had scraped together over the past years added up to enough to make even a pervish banker sit up and take notice. But I knew the futility of trying to convince Oz that there was ever such a thing as enough money.
Maybe I could just write about having dubious adventures instead of actually doing anything, I muttered.
That always sounded to me like a pretty cushy job to cash in on the good life.
You think so? Well, let me educate you to the harsh realities of the universe, partner. It's one thing to practice a skill or a hobby when you feel like it. But whether it's writing, singing, or playing baseball, when you've got to do something, whether you're up for it or not, it's work.
I could see this conversation was going nowhere. Oz simply wasn't going to see my point of view, so I decided to play dirty. I switched to his point of view.
Maybe I'd be more enthusiastic, I said, carefully,
if the kingdom's finances weren't at rock bottom. Doing something unpleasant to acquire a stack of debts doesn't strike me as all that great a deal.
Okay, it was hitting below the belt, but that just happens to be where pervex such as Oz are the most sensitive, which is to say, where they keep their wallets.
You've got a point there,
my partner said thoughtfully, wavering for the first time in the conversation.
Still, you managed to finagle a whole month before you have to make a decision. I figure in that time we should be able to get a pretty good fix on what the real financial situation is around here, and if it can be turned around.
There's just one problem with that, I pointed out. I know even less about money than I know about magic.
Just offhand, I'd say you were doing pretty well in both departments.
I caught the edge in my partner's voice and realized that he was on the brink of taking my comment personally, which is not surprising, as he was the one who had taught me nearly everything I know about magic and money.
Oh, I'm okay when it comes to personal finances and contract negotiations. More than okay, in fact.
And I have you to thank for that, I said hastily. What we're looking at now, though, is high finance, as in trying to manage the funds for a whole kingdom. I don't think that was covered in my lessons, or if it was, it went over my head.
Okay, that's a valid concern,
Oz conceded.
Still, it's probably the same thing you've been doing for Myth, Inc., but on a larger scale.
That's fine, except Bunny's been doing most of the heavy financial work for Myth, Inc., I grimaced.
I only wish she were here now.
She is, Oz exclaimed, clicking his fingers. That's the other reason I was looking for you.
Really? Where is she?
Waiting in your room. I wasn't sure what kind of sleeping arrangements you wanted to set up.
One of the changes from my previous stay at the palace was that, instead of sharing a room with Oz, I had a room of my own. It was a tribute to how worried I was, however, that the implications of what he said went right over my head.
Same as always, I said. See if we can find a room for her that's at least in the same wing of the palace as ours, though.
If you say so.
Oz shrugged.
Anyway, we'd better get going. She seemed real anxious to see you.
I only listened to this last with half an ear, as something else had momentarily caught my attention. I had turned away from Oz to give Gleep one last pat before we left, and for the barest fraction of a second saw something I had never noticed before. He was listening to us. Now, as I noted earlier, I've always maintained that Gleep was bright, but as I turned, I had a fleeting impression of intelligence in his expression. To clarify, there is a difference between bright and intelligent. Bright, as I'd always applied it to my pet, means that he is alert and quick to learn. Intelligent, on the other hand, goes beyond monkey-see-monkey-do tricks, all the way to independent thought. Gleep's expression as I turned was one of thoughtful concentration, if not calculation. Then he saw me looking at him and the look disappeared, to be replaced with his more familiar expression of eager friendliness. For some reason, this gave me a turn. Perhaps it was because I found myself remembering reports from the team about their efforts to disrupt the kingdom in my absence. Specifically, I was recalling the claim that Gleep had nearly killed Tananda, something I had dismissed at the time as being an accident that was being blown out of proportion in their effort to impress me with the difficulties of their assignment. Now, however, as I stared at my pet, I began to wonder if I should have paid closer attention to what they were saying. Then again, maybe it had just been the light playing tricks on me. Gleep certainly looked innocent enough now.
"Come on, partner," Oz repeated testily. "You can play with your dragon some other time. I still think we should try to sell that stupid beast off before he eats his way through our bankroll. He really doesn't add anything to our operation, except food bills."
Because I was already watching, I caught it this time. For the briefest moment, Gleep's eyes narrowed as he glanced at Oz, and an almost unnoticeable trickle of smoke escaped from one nostril. Then he went back to looking dopey and innocent. "Gleep's a friend of mine now, Oz," I said carefully, not taking my eyes off my pet. "Just like you and the rest of the crew are. I wouldn't want to lose any of you." My dragon seemed to take no notice of my words, craning his neck to look around the stable. Now, however, it seemed to me his innocence was exaggerated, that he was deliberately avoiding looking me in the eye.
"If you say so," Oz shrugged, heading for the door. "In the meantime, let's go see Bunny before she explodes."
I hesitated a moment longer, then followed him out of the stables. Chapter 2.
"It's good to see you too. H. Livingston, M.D."
As Oz had predicted, my three bodyguards were waiting for me outside the stables. They seemed to be arguing about something, but broke off their discussion and started looking vigilant as soon as I appeared. Now, you may think it would be kind of fun to have your own bodyguards. If so, you've never actually had one. What it really means is that you give up any notion that your life is your own. Privacy becomes a vague memory you have to work at recalling, as sharing has become the norm, starting with the food on your plate and ending with going to the John.
"Geez, boss, you know how many guys got whacked because somebody was hiding in the can? Just pretend we ain't here."
Then, too, there's the constant disquieting reminder that, however swell a fellow you may think you are, there are people out there waiting for a chance to bring your career to a premature conclusion. I had to keep telling myself that this latter point didn't apply to me, that Don Bruce had insisted on assigning me Guido and Nunzio more as status symbols than anything else. I had hired Pookie on my own, though, after getting jumped during my recent trip to Perv, so I couldn't entirely discount the fact that bodyguards were occasionally necessary and not just an inconvenient decoration.
"Got a minute, Skeeve?"
Pookie said, stepping forward.
"Well, I was on my way to say hello to Bunny."
"Fine, we can talk as we walk."
She fell in step beside me, and Oz graciously fell back to walk with my other two bodyguards.
"What it is," Pookie said without preamble, "is I'm thinking of cashing in and heading back to Perv."
"Really? Why?"
She gave a small shrug.
"I can't see how I'm really needed," she said. "When I suggested I tag along, we thought you were coming back to a small war. The way I see it now, it seems like the crew you've already got can handle things."
As she spoke, I snuck a glance back at Guido. He was trudging along, his posture notably more hangdog than usual. It was clear both that he was infatuated with Pookie and that he wasn't wild about the idea of her moving on.
"Actually, I'd prefer it if you stuck around for a while, Pookie," I said, "at least until I've made up my mind what to do about the situation with Queen Hemlock. She's been known to be a bit nasty when things don't go her way."
"Suit yourself,"
Pookie said, giving another shrug.
"I just wanted to give you an easy out if you were looking to trim the budget."
I gave a smile at that.
"Just because we're going to be working on the kingdom's finances doesn't mean there's anything wrong with our treasury. You should know your cousin well enough to have faith in his money managing.
I know Oz all right,
she said, shooting a dark look at that individual.
Enough to know that before he'd part with money unnecessarily, he'd cut off his arm, or more likely, someone else's.
He's mellowed a bit over the last few years, I smiled. But I know what you mean. If it makes you feel any better, though, I hired you, so I figure you're reporting directly to me and not to him. Pookie cocked an eyebrow at me.
If that wasn't the case, she said, I wouldn't have come along in the first place.
I could have let it go, but my curiosity was aroused. What's the problem between you two anyway? More specifically, what's your problem with Oz? He has nothing but the highest praise for you and your work. Pookie's features hardened, and she broke eye contact to stare straight ahead.
That's between him and me, she said stonily.
Her attitude puzzled me, but I knew better than to pursue the subject further. Oh, well, anyway, I'd like you to stick around if that's okay.
No problem from my end, she said. Just one thing, to ease my mind, could we adjust my pay scale? The prices you've been paying are my premium rates for short-term work. For longer-term employment, I can give you a discount.
How much? I said quickly. As I noted before, Oz had taught me most of what I know about money, and I had picked up some of his reflexes along the way.
Why don't we knock it down to the same rate you're paying those two?
She said, jerking a thumb at Guido and Nunzio.
If nothing else, it might avoid some hard feelings between us professionally.
Fine. I didn't have the heart to tell her that Guido and Nunzio were actually earning more than her premium rates. Realizing she was not only from the same dimension, but the same family as Oz, I wasn't sure how she'd take the news. With everything else on my mind, I decided to sort it out at a later date, like payday.
Well, that takes care of me, Pookie said. Any general orders for us?
Yes. Tell Nunzio I'd like to have a word with him. One thing about living in a palace is that it takes a long time to walk from anywhere to anywhere, giving us lots of time to have conferences on the way to other conferences. Hey, I didn't say that it was a nice thing about living in a palace, just a thing.
So, what's the word, boss?
Nunzio said, falling in step at my side.
Is she staying or going?
What? Oh, staying, I guess.
Whew, that's a relief,
he said, rolling his eyes briefly.
I'll tell you, I don't think Guido would be livable if she left right now. Know what I mean?
Uh-huh, I said, glancing back at his cousin, who, judging by the grin on his face, had already heard the news. He seems quite taken with her.
You don't know the half of it,
Nunzio grimaced.
So, what did you want to talk to me about?
Well, you know how you've been saying that Gleep has been acting strange lately?
Yeah, so?
He said, his squeaky voice taking on a cautious tone. I want you to try to spend more time with him. Talk to him. Maybe take him out for some exercise.
Me, boss?
Sure. You get along with him better than anyone, except maybe me, and I'm going to be tied up with the kingdom's finances for a while. If there's anything wrong with Gleep, I want to find out about it before anyone else gets hurt.
If you say so.
I couldn't help but notice an extreme lack of enthusiasm in his voice. Yes, I say so, I repeated firmly. It's important to me, Nunzio, and I can't think of anyone I'd trust more to check things out for me.
Okay, boss, he said, thawing a little. I'll get right on it.
I wanted to give him a bit more encouragement, but just then we arrived at the door to my quarters.
I'll wait out here, boss, and make sure nobody else comes in for a while,
Nunzio said with a faint smile as he stepped back. This surprised me a little, as the crew usually followed me into my room without missing a step or a syllable of conversation. Then I noticed that the others of the group had also halted short of the door and were watching me with a smile. I couldn't figure out what was going on. I mean, so Bunny was waiting inside. So what? It was just Bunny. Nevertheless, I took my cue, nodding at them vaguely as I opened the door.
Skeeve!
I barely turned around from shutting the door when Bunny charged across the room, slamming into me with a huge hug that took my breath away. Literally.
I was so worried about you,
she said, her voice muffled by my chest. Ack. That last comment was mine. Actually, it wasn't so much a comment as a noise I made while trying to force some air into my lungs. This proved easier said than done, and it wasn't all that easy to say.
Why didn't you come back to the office on your way back from Perv?
Bunny demanded, squeezing even harder and shaking me slightly.
I was going out of my mind, thinking about you all alone in that terrible dimension.
By ignoring what she was saying and focusing my entire consciousness on moving, I managed to slowly force one hand, then an arm, inside her embrace. Summoning my fast-fading strength, I levered my arm sideways, breaking her grip, and allowing myself a desperately needed rush of air. Okay, so it wasn't particularly affectionate, or even polite. It's just that I've picked up some annoying, selfish habits over the years, like breathing.
What's the matter, Skeeve?
Bunny said in a concerned voice, peering at me closely.
Are you all right?
I explained, realizing for the first time how sweet, plain air could taste.
I knew it, she snarled. Tananda kept saying you were all right. Every time I asked, she kept saying the same thing, that you were all right. The next time I see that little... I'm fine.
Really, Bunny, I'm fine. Still trying to get my lungs working on their own, I reached out a tentative finger and prodded her biceps. That was quite a hello, I said. I never realized you were so strong.
Oh, that?
She shrugged.
I've been working out a little while you were gone, like every night. Not much else to do evenings. It's an easier way to stay in shape than dieting.
Working out? My breathing was almost back to normal, but my head still felt a little woozy.
Sure, you know, pumping iron.
I had never realized that simple ironing could build up a woman's arms that much. I made a mental note to start sending our laundry out.
I'm sorry I didn't check in with you, I said, returning to the original subject.
It's just that I assumed you were okay there at the office and was in a hurry to see if the crew was okay.
Oh, I know. It's just that...
Suddenly, she was hugging me again, gentler this time.
Don't be mad at me, Skeeve,
she said softly from the depths of my chest.
I just get so worried about you sometimes.
I was surprised to realize she was trembling. I mean, it just wasn't that cold here in the room, especially not huddled together the way we were.
I'm not mad at you, Bunny, I said.
And there was nothing to worry about, really. Everything went fine on Perv.
I heard that you nearly got killed in a fight,
she countered, tightening her grip slightly.
And wasn't there some kind of trouble with the cops?
That annoyed me a little. The only way she could have found out about the trouble I ran into on Perv would be from Tananda. Except I hadn't told Tananda anything about it before she headed back to the bazaar to relieve Bunny. That meant that either Oz or Pookie was telling people about my escapades, and, to say the least, I wasn't wild about that.
Where did you hear that?
I said casually.
It's all over the bazaar,
Bunny explained, burrowing further into my chest.
Tananda said you were fine, but I had to see for myself after everything I heard.
Come on, Bunny, I said soothingly, mentally apologizing to Oz and Pookie. You know how everything gets exaggerated at the bazaar. You can see I'm fine. She started to say something, then turned her head as sounds of an argument erupted through the closed door.
What's that?
I don't know, I admitted. Guido and Nunzio said they were going to keep everybody out for a while. Maybe someone... The door burst open, and Queen Hemlock stood framed in the entryway. Behind her, my bodyguard stood, and as they caught my eye, gave exaggerated shrugs. Apparently, royalty was harder to stop than your average assassin, a thought that did little to cheer me, realizing some of the rumors surrounding the current matriarch of Posseltum.
There you are, Skeevy,
the queen exclaimed, striding into my room.
I was looking all over for you when I saw those thugs of yours loitering outside. Who is this?
Your Majesty, this is Bunny. Bunny, this is Queen Hemlock.
Your Majesty,
Bunny said, sinking into a deep bow. It occurred to me that as worldly as she was in some ways, Bunny had never met a member of royalty before, and seemed to be quite awed by the experience. Queen Hemlock, on the other hand, was not at all overawed by meeting another commoner.
"Why, Skeeve, she's lovely,"
she says, cupping Bunny's chin in her hand and raising her head to view her face.
"I was starting to wonder a bit about you, what with that monstrous apprentice of yours, not to mention that lizard thing you brought back with you from wherever, but this. It's nice to know you can find a yummy morsel when you set your mind to it."
"Bunny's my administrative assistant," I said, a bit stiffly.
"Why, of course,"
the queen smiled, giving me a broad wink.
"Just like my young men are bodyguards. On the kingdom budget, anyway."
"Please, your majesty, don't misunderstand," Bunny said. "Skeeve and I are really just..."
"There, there, my dear,"
Hemlock interrupted, taking Bunny by the hands and drawing her to her feet.
"There's no need to worry about me being jealous. I wouldn't dream of interfering in Skeeve's personal life before or after we're married, any more than I'd expect him to interfere in mine. As long as he does the air thing to keep the rabble happy, it doesn't really matter to me what he does with the rest of his time."
I really didn't like the way this conversation was going and hastened to change the subject.
You said you were looking for me, Your Majesty?
Oh, yes,
the queen said, releasing her hold on Bunny's hands.
I wanted to tell you that Grimble was waiting to see you at your earliest convenience. I told him that you'd be giving him a hand straightening out the kingdom's finances, and he's ready to give you whatever information or assistance you need.
Somehow, that didn't sound like the J.R. Grimble I knew, but I let it slide for the moment. "Very well. We'll be along presently."
"Of course,"
the queen smiled, winking at me again.
"Well, I'll just be running along then."
As she reached the door, she paused to sweep Bunny once more with a lingering gaze.
"Charming," she said. "You really ought to be congratulated, Skeeve."
There was an uncomfortable silence after the queen left. Finally, I cleared my throat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.